him, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Almighty God, we thank you, Lord, for this glorious day that you've given us, this opportunity to worship you, O Lord, in spirit and in truth. We know, Lord, that the victory is ours.
Yeah. in the vision of the psalm. From the Good News Translation, today's English version, talks about God and human being. And it reads from verse 1 to verse 12 in this manner. O Lord, you have always been our home. Before you created the hills or brought the world into being, you were eternally God and will be God forever. Amen. You tell us to return to what we were. You change us back to dust. 1,000 years to you are like one day. They are like yesterday, already gone, like a short hour in the night. You carry us away like a flood. We last no longer than a dream. We are like weeds that sprout in the morning, that grow and burst into bloom, then dry up and die in the evening. We are destroyed by your anger. We are terrified by your fury. You place our sins before you, our secret sins, where you can see them. Our life is cut short by your anger. It fades away like a whisper. 70 years is all we have. 80 years if we are strong. Yet all they bring us is trouble and sorrow. Life is soon over and we are gone. Who has felt the full power of your anger? Who knows what fear your fury can bring? But teach us how short our life is, so that we may become wise. This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen.
Good morning, Queen Street. I'll be reading from Mark chapter 10, verses 35 to 45. I'll be reading from the New International Version. Father, I do want to thank you, Queen Street, and the men of the church for your support on last Sunday for our music and worship. I also want to thank Sister Lamb and her crew for the gifts that they gave to the men on last Sunday. I was telling her this morning that I really appreciated the pocket handkerchief, because I usually leave home on Sunday morning with at least three. So that kind of helped me out quite a bit. Mark chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us what we ask you. What do you want me to do for you, he said. They replied, let one of us sit on your right and the other on your left in glory. You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Yes, sir. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. But to sit on the right and the left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers over the Gentiles lord over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not with you, instead. Whosoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whosoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Whosoever wants to be great among you must become a servant. Must become a servant. God bless you.
Amen. It's prayer time. We're going to ask the elder. He's going to come. He's going to lead us to the throne of grace this morning. And elder, when you offer prayer, we ask that you would also offer prayer over the offertory. We thank the Lord for good stewardship.
Let's all bow and pray. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, the Creator, the Giver, the Sustainer and Redeemer of our life, it is in that matchless, that miraculous, that mighty name of Jesus the Christ that we humbly assemble ourselves in this your house of worship one more time. And we bow down, O God, before you, your holy presence. We do so in spirit and in truth. Lord, we lift our sensitive spirits to your most holy spirit and pray that the words of our mouth, meditation of our heart, the walk of our everyday lives will be acceptable in your sight. We come, Lord, with praises on our tongues, for you are worthy to be praised. We come, Lord, with the utmost thanksgiving in our hearts for who you are, what you are, and what you mean in our lives. 24/7. Most of all, Lord, we thank you for your Son Jesus, who intercedes for us with unconditional redeeming love and unmerited grace and mercy. And in him, Lord, we have a lively hope concerning our salvation and a crown of eternal life in your kingdom. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this day of life and the joy of this wishing experience. This joy that the world can give us and the world can take away. We lift up to you, Lord, the concerns and the needs, the aspiration of each of our church members, their families, their loved ones. We pray, Lord, your blessings, your guidance, your direction for our church, its ministries, its programs, and the evangelical work of this your house and people on Rebels Avenue. We pray, Lord, that we would continue to be a source of light and hope for this community. Dedicated and able leadership, your undershepherd, and our beloved pastor. We pray your continued blessings on him and his family. Help us, Lord, to continue to work together in Christian love, harmoniously, as servants of the Most High God, with love and respect for one another. Pray that you would touch the hearts and the minds of our youth and our young adults. Pray that you would give them a sense of hope, a sense of respect, a sense of belonging. Then we pray, Lord, a special blessing upon our nation. We pray, Lord, for the leadership of our state, the leadership of the country. Pray that you would benefit them, Lord, as they take their office with your Holy Spirit and a measure of your wisdom, and guide them, O Lord, in the path of righteousness, that they go about the duties of our communities, our neighborhoods, our country. Hundreds and thousands
heart to receive. We pray that you would multiply his usefulness. Make it, O God, what you would have it to be. And bless those who give continuously.
Come and run the Lord.
Amen, amen. That's a great reminder that God never fails. Church, our sermonic text this morning is coming from Joshua, familiar scripture, Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. And I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version of God's Word. This is what it says. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, "My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the Israelites. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, as I promised to Moses. From the wilderness and the Lebanon as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites to the great sea in the west shall be your territory. No one shall be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land that I swore to their ancestors to give them." God's word for the people of God, all praises be to God.
Spirit, God, and your word by
out of grace divine. Let my soul look up with steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Oh God, as I stand behind your sacred desk, allow my presence to diminish until there's none of me but all of thee. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
And amen. I'd like us to think for a few moments upon the subject, picking up from verse 2. My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan. Now proceed to cross the Jordan. If there is one thing that we need during this pandemic and during this polarizing political season, it is a word of inspiration to proceed, Deacon, to progress, to keep on going forward. We could say that arguably there has been no other period in recent history that has had more of a collective impact upon our communities and our lives than what we are seeing right now. As we consider specifically the pandemic, the number of confirmed cases globally and nationally and regionally is staggering. The cases seen in our own households. I would dare say that there is not one of us here who has not been touched in some way, shape, or form by this pandemic. It seems as though in an instant our lives have been turned upside down. We're shocked and we're bewildered and we're left confused. And so we find ourselves rocked to the very core. Our anxiety is high. Some of us are wound up like a clock. And while we need to practice social distancing, like we're doing today, we need to do that with one another. But we also know, Deacon Poe, that we need to stay close to God. Now more than ever, Diane, we need to stay close to God. Now, this idea of intimately connecting with God during a communal crisis is not new. All we've got to do is look at the text. Come here and see that as we consider this commission of Joshua in this passage. To put it in context, we know that Joshua is facing a crisis in the community. It's the death of Moses. We cannot say enough about how his death has thrown Israel into a state of emergency. The Bible makes it clear. No prophet has risen since in Israel like Moses, whom God knew face to face. We've got to remember that he was the vessel for working miracles. He boldly called for the liberation of Israel from Egyptian captivity. He went before Pharaoh with Aaron and he spoke truth to power. He led God's people through the Red Sea on dry ground. He received the Ten Commandments written by the hand of God. And so his death brings national grief and despondency. People are hurt. They're heartbroken. It's a crisis. And in many ways, we too, we face a crisis today. There continues to be not just one crisis, but I would say crises all across the land. Yes, the pandemic. Yes, the political landscape. Yes, we're witnessing earthquakes. Yes, we're seeing wildfires. There are crises across the landscape. The nation is tragically divided. Or maybe the wide divide has simply exposed what has always been there. But it's a crisis. So what do we do, Dr. Peggy? What do we do? Well, the first thing we see is that Joshua and Israel, they find themselves in a new place. That's what the scripture tells us. They're heading to a new place geographically, Jordan, the promised land. And they find themselves in a new place contextually. The scripture says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, "My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan." Israel must now wrestle with the reality that Moses, their anchor, their sense of stability, is no longer present. That which seemed to guide them and sustain them through their darkest hours and most frightening moments is no longer there. Moses was like their North Star. He was their lodestone. When Israel rebelled and acted reckless, he was the one who could get them back on track. As a global community, as a national community, we find ourselves in a new place. We're fighting over whether we should wear masks to protect ourselves and others. Whether we should wear a mask as a good neighbor. And as sad as it is, we have some faith communities that have politicized wearing a mask.
Yes, sir.
The church, so used to fellowship, cannot come together and worship as we used to do. We're in a new place. We find ourselves in a new place where social justice is denounced. The prophet Isaiah, he said, you who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. You who are wise in your own eyes and shrewd in your own sight. We find ourselves in what a place we're in. It's upside down. When we see folk pledging allegiance to a flag that was used in an insurrection at our nation's capital, it's upside down. We find ourselves in a place that is new, but it's not really new. I think about the prophet Ezekiel. The prophet Ezekiel found himself in a new place when God showed him a panoramic view of the valley of dry bones. And Ezekiel was called to speak life into that catastrophic condition. And when God asked him rhetorically, "Can these bones live?" I would dare say that God is speaking to every one of us. Is there a prophet in the house who can respond? Can these bones live?
Well,
Ezekiel said, "Oh Lord, God, you know. The condition may look bad, but God, you know. It may appear as though we are despondent and dead, as though we're lifeless and cannot get up. But God, you know."
Yes.
"It appears as though we are in a vast valley with many dry bones."
Yeah.
But as he spoke life to the disassembled, fragmented, and separated, what happened? They united. They came together. You see, beloved, now is the time more than ever as the body of Christ.
Well, yeah.
To come together now more than ever.
Oh, yeah.
The church is called to live out its commission, to speak life, to speak truth, to speak life, to speak truth,
yeah.
To speak truth,
well.
To speak truth, to speak truth,
well. Well.
To speak truth,
yeah.
To power,
yes, sir.
In a world of brokenness.
Well.
So it's all right. It's all right. We can say that it was an insurrection. That's speaking truth. It's all right. We can say that the former president was corrupt. That's all right. We can say that Joseph Biden won the election and is our fully elected president. It's all right to speak truth to power. In the second instance, we find ourselves in a new place. But we're operating on an old promise. Let me show you what I mean. See, every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you as I promised to Moses. Joshua leads Israel while in a new place and to a new place, but he does so with an old promise. Now God tells Joshua that every place that his foot touches, I have given to you as I promised Moses. Huh? It's not that I'm considering it, or I'm anticipating it, or I plan to do it. It's not some type of conjecture. I've already given it to you. It's not in the future tense as though it is going to happen. It's not the present tense happening right now. It's past tense. It has already happened. I've already given it to you. It's like we're saying, don't wait until the battle is over. You can go ahead and shout right now. He said, every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you as I promised to Moses. Oh, we're here today because God made a promise to our grandmother and our grandfather and our mother and our dad. We've inherited a promise, but we've got to speak those things that are not as though they are. And we've got to stand on those old promises, because what is impossible with man is possible with God. Has God promised you anything? Or doesn't God keep his word? And we're making it today because God promised that he would not leave us nor forsake us. We're making it today because he said, just as I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. We're standing on some promises. We cannot trivialize the seriousness of this moment with church cliches and negating science and medicine. We need strong, a solid, sustaining faith. We need to stand on the promises of God.
Yes.
Deacon Cynthia, God has promised us a comforter.
Yes.
Diane, he promised us a healer. He has promised that if we acknowledge him in all our ways, that he will guide and direct our paths. And even during this time, when money is funny because of an economic collapse, God promised that if we bring all of the tithes into the storehouse, that there will be enough, that he'll open up the windows of heaven and he'll pour out blessings that we don't have room enough to receive. Somebody is standing on a promise today. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I'm going to heal the land. We're standing on some promises. We can see that we're at a new place. promise. But here's the shout. We've got the same presence. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I won't fail you nor forsake. See, it's Joshua's turn to lead the procession to where God would have them to go. Moses had climbed to the top of the mountain, and he saw the promised land. And God told him that he could see it from a distance because he was not going to cross over into it. And so God gives Joshua the assignment. God tells Joshua, my servant Moses is dead. So you and all these folk, get ready to cross over to the land that I promised you. A promised land. A land where there's concern for your neighbors. A promised land. A land where the hungry are fed, and the thirsty are given drink, and the stranger is invited in, and the naked are clothed, and the sick and incarcerated are visited. Come on in to the promised land. A land empowered in its commitment to care for the vulnerable and the marginalized. The promised land. A place where principled politicians are more concerned about people and compassionate policies rather than power and financial profit. The promised land. And we're crossing over to a new place, a promised land. In our separatedness, we found a new sense of coming together, a promised land. And during this perilous time, we need to remember that God is still with us. And we've got some healthcare workers on the front line. And first responders are protecting us, and neighborhoods are acting neighborly. And we do have some elected officials that are working for their constituents. And we are being kept informed, and churches are ministering. God is still with us in the midst of all that we're going through. God says, as I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. I won't fail you, and I won't forsake you. We can move forward because of the power of God's presence. But before I take my seat, can I show you something that the Holy Spirit showed me? Look at verse 2. My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I'm giving to them. Now proceed to cross. That's a shout. When I read that, an inescapable truth jumps out to me. You see, it's not only proceed to cross, but it reminds me, proceed to the cross. Not just to cross, but to the cross. Because there's so much power in the cross. Oh, be not dismayed. Perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but not abandoned. We're struck down, but not destroyed. Suffering breeds character. Character breeds faith. And in the end, faith will not disappoint. Martin Luther King said it, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. Now proceed to the cross. Amen. Amen. Can't stop. We used to sing that song, ain't no stopping us now. We got a flashback. We gotta keep on going. Amen, amen. Now let's stand once and extend the invitation. Introducing some of us, our God.